Parental discretion is advised.
Find yourself in the Beachview area of Pittsburgh? Check out the official pizza of this show, Slice on Broadway, sharing an abnormal obsession with pizza we can relate to. Check them out at sliceonbroadway.com and tell them this show sent you. Hey guys, it's the Wrestling Mayhem Show 497. I'm Mike Sorg at Sorgatron on Twitter's in the Mayhem Studio in Pittsburgh, PA. We're ready to talk about some professional wrestling. First of all, with me, he is some circles. He's a hobo named Sawtooth Willie. In some circles, he's a host of Panel Riot at PanelRiot.com, talking about all your comic book needs and talking to really fancy people about comic books. But here he's Papa Lunchbox, and we love his lunchbox. At Dj Lunchbox on the Twitters. How are you, sir?
I'm lovely. I'm cold, obviously, and very tired. I'm hard at work. I interviewed all the fanciest people for Panel Riot episode 50, and I'm hard at work at it. It'll be out soon, I promise.
I promise
it'll be out soon.
I can't wait. And also joining us, he has returned home to Poughkeepsie, New York, the only guy on the show who holds a future endeavor letter from WWE corporate office. It's Mad Mike.
Sorg, I am preparing my weaponry for Grey Thursday and Black Friday, just in case I have to shank someone while I'm at work.
There you go. Holding down the front lines at the Toys R Us. Also with us locally here in the Pittsburgh area, he's our friend in the mainstream. He's also the writer of the fantastic columns over on WrestlingMayhemShow.com and around the indies at IndieWrestling.us. Mainstream Matt on the Twitter is 1T, Matt Carlins.
Good news, Sorg. At the rate things are going, we could have higher ratings than Raw in about 2 or 3 months.
Nice. Nice. We were talking about the local news, right?
No, I'm talking about us.
I thought you were talking about your stuff. Okay, yeah, all right, that's good, good.
That's top of the line. One more day of ratings, baby. Let's do this. Finish strong.
All right. And of course, this is your Wrestling Mayhem Show where we talk about professional wrestling at WrestlingMayhemShow.com. Check out this and all of the other shows, Indie Mayhem Show, Midweek Wars, Raw Wrap-Ups, all the like. I'll take a little bit of a hiatus, actually. No wrap-up this week. And I don't know if you guys are doing Midweek Wars or not as well. You take it easy here for the holiday, but your main shows are here. And you can subscribe to all of them on iTunes, YouTube, and all the video and audio formats we have over there. And also, please follow us at Mayhem Show on the Twitter and follow the Facebook, and especially the Facebook group where we have a lot of discussion. And we like to share animated GIFs with each other of the New Day dancing with Wade Barrett. And I'm sure Matt Carnes was a big fan of that the other day. Yeah.
Big fan. Big week for Wade. Very excited for him.
You can also
shaking his ass.
Also, drop us a line to 412-206-WMS0 or send your animated GIFs directly to us at
Good Times at WrestlingMayhemShow.com.
And I forget what else to do after that. Basic Sickness, the intro and outro theme.
2-6.
We already did that part. We did that part. Basic Sickness, thanks to him for the intro, actual music, basicsickness.com, another Pittsburgh original. And please join us here live every Tuesday about 9 p.m. Eastern time at live.wrestlingmayhemshow.com. Also, you can support the show on patreon.com/wrestlingmayhemshow, just like the fine, fine people like Bo Diggity. As well as the great Antonio Garza down there in Texas representing the WrestlingRevolution.com. And also keeping us updated on the Facebook group with what's happening in AAA and Mexican wrestling and translating it to things we understand in American wrestling. I really appreciate that. Especially when he says, look what happens. And it's a video that's all in Spanish and I have no idea. And then he translates it for me. I love it. It's worldwide. I love it. And also some people on Twitter have been telling me about what's going on in the tag world championship that's happening out in Japan right now. What was it called?
I think it's the World Tag League.
That sounds right. So also thanks to Edward Burke, and we're actually having some fun conversations with him, LB, about that RPG we were talking about last week. Yes. And also our friends at the Matthew and Jennifer Carlins Foundation for Podcast Betterment, which includes Matt Carlins.
Take my money, Sorg.
Yes, and you can do the same at patreon.com/wrestlingmayhemshow. Hey, executive producer is $5 and up, Mark. If you've been with us for 4 weeks on that level, we give you business cards. We just sent out a really cool set of business cards to a couple people over on the Awesome Cast Patreon. And if you guys want to, that is an option as well over at wrestlingmayhemshow.com. And you can put that on a resume. You can represent it. You are an executive producer. You're helping fund the show. And Mad Mike's already tired. He's yawning over there.
Sorg, I've already been forced to eat a lot of turkey. My mother makes a lot.
Tie off that tryptophan. So let's get right into the show. First of all, we are post-Survivor Series here. 25 years of The Undertaker has concluded. First of all, I don't know about you guys, but it hit all the marks for me as an Undertaker fan. Anybody else? No?
Yeah.
Is it just me? Yes. Yes.
It was really lackluster.
Why was it lackluster for you?
It was the same thing they did on Raw.
Okay.
Like something, a gimmick, something. I don't know.
I think it was a nice presentation. I thought the entrance did a lot for him. I thought, we saw them beat them up and kind of a schmoz on Raw, but I still think it was very representative of Undertaker. It was a good homage on the show, and I think that's more memorable than just on a random Raw. So that's my take on it.
I feel like there's been this backlash against the Undertaker and all the Undertaker things lately, because I think a lot of people got it in their heads like, okay, well, he's done. He's going to hang it up. He's going to retire. And then he didn't. And people are like, well, why didn't this thing happen that I wanted to have happen? Mm-hmm. I hate him now. And I feel like there's a lot of negativity being thrown at the Undertaker, but I don't see it. I think it's great. I think he's doing amazing work. If this is to be his last run, good on him. Good for him.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. What about you, Matt? How did you feel about the Undertaker match on Sunday?
I convinced myself that they were beating the crap out of the Wyatt family so many times on free television that surely the Wyatt family would beat them on pay-per-view, but then that didn't happen.
Nope.
I was like, well, damn it. Mad Mike was right. They never win.
Never win.
But that point aside, it's what am I supposed to do? I mean, it's fine. It's The Undertaker. It's Kane. Kane's best years are far behind him. I like the tag team deal is good. It's better than having to put them in a singles match, even though I'm sure we'll get another Undertaker singles match, obviously, down the line. I don't know, Sorg. It was just kind of there. They came, they saw, they did their thing.
They tombstone.
Really happy.
They tombstone. They spewed fire. They threw somebody through the table. And there
they
you go.
They sit up together. Come on.
They sit up together.
Come on. Tell me that doesn't
now,
give you a wrestling boner.
You knew there was no way they were losing that match after you do
the
double
thing.
Setup. You're like, okay.
If you expected more than just like an Undertaker homage in this entire thing, I don't know what, you know, I think that's all you really needed. Wyatts were set up to be a big bad, and this wasn't going beyond Survivor Series. You don't do 25 years of Undertaker to set up for something at TLC. This was the end of it. This last month was the setup. And Wyatts, I think, came back the next day, became they were destroying things and getting ready for the next thing.
But I have a question. Why did we need to bury Bray Wyatt in the process? We could have just had.
Did you? Because Bray didn't get the pin.
Use of the word buried.
Yeah, this isn't a bury.
No, I mean that literally he buries them alive because Bray Wyatt's the line. But you know, I was trying to do an homage.
I was going
to
say
he neither figuratively or literally buried them alive. But I think you're being a little. I think you're overcooking it a little bit. I mean, Bray Wyatt didn't even take the pinfall in this match.
No, he didn't. No, and I think
it breaks a little bit.
I think
they had a 4-on-2 advantage and couldn't win.
Of course. So the Wyatt family failed, and Bray Wyatt as the leader failed. But I don't think burial is the right word.
I mean,
the word you're looking for.
They could have put Bray Wyatt in the world title tournament and just done a tribute to The Undertaker. And accomplish the same exact thing, and maybe even something better now seeing that, you know, no one's too jazzed about Sheamus. Bray Wyatt as a heel champion would have been awesome going into TLC.
But Bray Wyatt is a heel monster who can't win matches. He's not allowed to win matches. He's got to be scary, and he's got to really creep people out.
Yeah. You know who else was a heel monster? The Undertaker.
Yeah, but Undertaker won matches. That's the difference between him and Kane and Bray Wyatt.
And the Undertaker,
those guys were scary, but they were ultimately there to be conquered.
And the Undertaker didn't remain a heel monster forever either. He became too likable after just like a year or two, and Bray's still in the...
Okay, I'd argue that, but like at least Taker was heel for at least 3 or 4 years. At least.
Jake, I only remember one WrestleMania where...
No, he was turned by the time he got to Jake.
Yeah.
Mania 8. So he was faced by Mania 8. That's,
he had Superfly at 7.
That's less than 2 years.
Yeah, definitely less than 2 years. So, I mean, again, you know, he had to lose to somebody if he was, which was Hulk Hogan in the end. And I don't even know who else in that first year, to be honest. So they did that. And then they turned him around because he was too good of a character the other way. Bray doesn't need to win matches to be a monster. He can go out there with his army, destroy people like he did with the Dudleys. And now he's a monster again. And it doesn't matter if you know, to build him to the next big opponent. Is more important.
He doesn't look like a threat. He's about as much of a threat as Kane.
All right, we'll agree to disagree so we can move on with all the right. podcast then. Yeah. Because okay. we're not this is the same argument we have every week on this one. But no, other than that, we got our Not Deadly Game tournament, and I knew that Roman Reigns was in trouble when we had Hulk Hogan colored confetti coming down. I'm not, you know, other than it's Sheamus, although Sheamus playing the part of Randy Orton was really ironic, considering, you know, how we felt about Orton and Sheamus over the summer here. But to play the part of the spoiler, and it gives him something. And I'm just glad that now Rusev and Barrett have something to do as his lackeys. And Matt, how are you feeling about that?
On Raw, on Monday night, I sat down on my couch, and I sat down and I put my hands on it, and I was like, all right, Sheamus, let's do it. He came out. I gotta be honest, fans were not interested at first, but damn it, Sheamus warmed him up, got him going, got him mad at him, and after 10 minutes in one promo, I was pretty much feeling Sheamus as champion. I was feeling like, okay, I can get into this. I'm down with this. And then you tag on Rusev and you tag on Barrett. I think I can get down with this too. The only worry I have is that maybe Sheamus is in danger, that in 2 weeks at TLC, we might not want him to lose. Mm-hmm. Because he might be too good at being an obnoxious, gloating champion that will kind of be like, I think I'm okay with this. I think I can roll with this for another month or so. That's how I feel. I feel like, and they said it, they teased it. They teased the championship match on Raw on Monday. I think they should have just done it there. You heard that crowd. They wanted Roman to beat Sheamus right there and then. They should have done it right there and then. I'm worried that if they wait 2 or 3 more weeks, people will get into Sheamus. And I honestly am worried about that. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I'm with you. The whole time, like the structure of Raw last night, like I loved how the last few months we did have the thread of what's going on with Seth, right? You know, I talk about it. I like the interstitials throughout the show, and the most kind of developed thing through the show, like, was going into the Divas match, right? I feel like without that, because they haven't built up that story with Seth over so many months, it made the show feel disjointed like it used to, right? We had a segment at the beginning, which led to a segment 3 hours later. And then a bunch of stuff in the middle. That didn't, right. You know, that nothing connected. Like, it seemed so, like, unusually, even more so than usual, random on Raw last night. But segment per segment, like, each one worked, but nothing kind of put together a good show overall. You know what I mean? Now, you mentioned the ratings, actually, at the beginning of the show, Matt. Did they take another dive?
It took another dive, and I can find you the specifics on it if you give me another second to do it. But I think the number I know the average viewership was under 3 million. That's definitely a non-holiday low.
Oof.
Stand by. I'll get you the specifics on in a second. You guys just keep complaining.
That's fine.
About
that. That's fine. But I mean, that's and then they popped up for the Divas last week too, which really kind of like what's great. Yo, good. Do more Divas stuff, and I think they really gave them a bit of a platform this week as well. And I thought it was better than usual Divas stuff for sure. Not on the level that we saw in NXT, I know, but I think it's a different environment in general. So I don't know if we're, I honestly don't know if we're going to get a Sasha versus Bayley type match. You won't see it on Raw, but, you know, are we going to get those at the pay-per-views eventually? I think we have good matches on the pay-per-views with these ladies right now with Charlotte on top. But again, not tremendous. But then again, I mean, you're not going to get it every month, right?
Right. Going back to the ratings point here, I'm going to paraphrase from the write-up on WrestleZone per the great Dave Meltzer that the final Raw rating was 2.16, down from last week's 2.28. It was a new non-holiday low, 2.96 million viewers, and that is the lowest since wait for it. Less than the previous low total nearly 19 years ago. So the lowest in 19 years, I guess.
Jesus.
Wait. 19 now, years ago, like during the Monday Night War?
I guess the very beginning of the Attitude Era. Just the very, 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 very beginning of the Attitude Era.
You're right, 96.
When it was cool and nobody was watching it yet.
Right. 90, like, so the 96, that would have been... They were just probably coming back around and changing things. Wow. And they don't have like a WCW to compete against them. They just have, well, they have cell phones and they have TV and they have video games and everything else. So,
and
I mean,
football.
I mean, isn't a lot of TV and football, of course, isn't a lot of TV. Like I was hearing about, and I don't know if you got this, Matt, on your side, that like regular TV ratings, network TV ratings are like down 6%. Like season over season.
Right. And there's an ongoing discussion going on, not just in the realms of professional wrestling, but across television about how relevant the current rating system is. I mean, you're looking at an overnight rating from Nielsen, which doesn't take into account DVR numbers and things like that. In fact, the Fox network has actually made some news either earlier this week or late last week that they were going to do away with the overnight Nielsen numbers when kind of touting their ratings. They were going to go to a model which is known as like live plus 3 days of DVR, or live plus 7 days of DVR, feeling that those are more representative of how many people are actually watching. Is that the case for Raw? Are a bunch of people just DVRing Raw and watching it over the next 3 to 7 days? And is that where all the viewers are going? Does WWE have data that's telling them that that's the case, so they're not worried? Shrug. I don't know.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, it's definitely the ratings are fragmented. They're all over the place. It's a situation everyone in television is dealing with this right now.
But meanwhile,
I don't know what else to say,
Shark, something you said about the ratings, like going down 6% every year or along those lines. I was actually listening to a podcast earlier today where they were talking about the Aaron Sorkin show Sports Night. It was his first TV show, right?
Right.
And that show got canceled because it wasn't getting good ratings, right?
Right.
The ratings it was getting were 13 and 16 million viewers per episode.
Right.
And it got canceled for that.
Right. Well, and I got mad a couple years ago. So Friday night, there was the Terminator series they had going for a bit. And there was Dollhouse after that. And they were actually getting more ratings on Terminator than they were Dollhouse. Canceled Terminator. But I think also the thing is the cost of the show. Like, in order for it to make sense for what all they put into it in marketing, it needs to get X amount. And even though it was getting, like, more than what Raw's getting, for instance, right now, you know, it wasn't enough to kind of sustain that. So it's an interesting thing with TV. Now I think in contrast to that, this turned into a ratings discussion rather than a Survivor Series. But a few months ago in an earnings call, I believe it was, they talked about how more people are watching, say, Survivor Series, pay-per-views, all WrestleMania in particular, than have ever watched these shows. despite lower ratings on Raw, more people are watching their bigger events that they are directly getting now. The money in hand from our $9.99 a month, and sponsorships for your K Jewelers Presents TLC, for instance.
Hey, Sword, K Jewelers, and Toys R Us.
And Toys R Us. Mike's excited about that one. they get the money from that and don't have to split as much of it with, say, pay-per-view companies or anything else, any of those other little ads that you're seeing on there as well, or for Rolaids or whatever, right?
Exactly.
So they get a bigger piece of that pie. So while they do have to battle that USA Network still proving their value as they're putting another show on USA Network here coming up, they're still not doing as bad, I guess. Can I say like one's going down, but one's coming up, and I wonder where that median's going to end up being. So I don't know. Any other thoughts here before we go talk about the other ways that WWE is making money in toys as we talk about Black Friday here in a moment?
I just wanted to say that, I mean, overall, I thought as a whole, the WWE World Heavyweight Championship tournament was pretty good. We got a lot of good quality matches.
Yeah.
I was a little bummed with the finals. I felt like the finals just wasn't long enough. I just wanted like just 5 more minutes of just Dean and Roman doing their thing. And that kind of like bummed me out a little bit, because it's not like they had to be in some huge rush. They had like 10 minutes left like when they went off the air.
Yeah, didn't they like...
That's kind of like the only complaint I had about the tournament as a whole.
They needed more time to come back and dwell on Roman leaving the ring, I guess.
More tears. More tears, Roman.
Tears for Roman. Tears for Roman. But I don't know. It's interesting. I thought... I'm with you. I think they're making as good of moves as they possibly can with the roster right now. Again,
we all said that they needed a new top heel because they didn't have Seth anymore. They had we need a new top heel.
Yeah.
Pick a guy. I don't care who you get. Pick a guy. So whether it was going to be Del Rio or Owens, who were all going to end up cheering anyways, or if it was Sheamus, they needed a new top heel. So Sheamus is the guy. Makes sense.
He's somebody who's been around, somebody they can put stock in. You know what I mean? He's a company guy that's been around for 6-7 years. So they know.
He's European Randy Orton.
And he's European Randy Orton. I see him as more excitable than that, than European Randy Orton.
Good to great matches, experienced, underrated on the microphone, as evidenced by Raw last Monday.
Mm-hmm.
He can do it.
He just
needs the machine behind him.
Yes, he does. So we'll see what happens with that, and this may just be gearing up. When is the next Ninja Turtles movie come out? So
not till summer.
Not till the summer. So I mean, you know, I can't wait till the Night of Champions match that he has against Steve Amell. So
Sork, if you think he's making it past the beginning of 2016, you're kidding yourself.
Wait, about Sheamus?
Yeah,
he's
losing it. He's losing at TLC.
I didn't say he's going to be champion. No. We're just scared.
I was
going to
say.
No,
he's losing at TLC, and we're getting Roman versus Triple H for two
minutes. No. That all is going to happen with the belt or whatever, but I mean, we're going to build Sheamus up. You'd be like, look how important he is. He's in this movie, yada, 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 you know. That sort of thing.
Well, I think they want to see how much of him is actually in it and how much is CGI rhinos.
That's true, too. CGI Sheamus rhinos. Anyways, hey, you know what's not CGI? Pizza from Slice on Broadway.
Hot damn.
Hey, non-CGI pizza, here we go. Check them out, sliceonbroadway.com. Some great stuff from some great people supporting Pittsburgh podcasting with the perfect pepperoni pizza for well over a year and a half here. That's just the clouds or something. That's the wrong one. There you go. I hit the wrong computer. Sorry about that. but anyways, no, check them out. Some great people here along the tracks in the South Hills of Peachburg, Pittsburgh, in the Beachview area, and also down in Carnegie, PA, Mike. Down on the main street down there. Say hi to the guys, Rico and the guys down there making some other stuff there. No tears for Roman, no tears for this pizza. It's so great. And check them out. Perfect Pizza, Slice on Broadway. PJ's underscore slice on the Twitters. Tell them out. Check them out. Let them know you'd heard about them on the Wrestling Mayhem Show and on Facebook and Instagram as well. All right. So let's talk about some Black Friday.
Black Friday.
Brought to you by K Jewelers and Toys R Us. He's getting the chills. I am with you. My brother works at Walmart. So, and beyond. My brother.
It starts on Thursday.
I know.
5 p.m., Sorg.
We're having a very interesting timing for our Thanksgiving dinner because they have to go to work on Thursday. I feel so bad for them.
I've spent a winter or two moonlighting at Toys R Us, and I got to tell you, Black Friday is no joke.
All I've done is Spencer.
It's no joke.
All I've done is Spencer.
You're one of
gifts.
Those, Carlins.
I've seen it, man. I've seen it myself.
Unbelievable. Try Halloween at Spencer's Gifts.
Oh, man.
Oh, yeah.
Hold, wait.
Sorg.
Yes?
Are you legitimately comparing Halloween at Spencer's Gifts to Black Friday at a toy store?
No, absolutely not. Absolutely not.
I worked
Black
Friday.
I will cut you with a lightsaber, Sorg.
I worked Black Friday at a Best Buy for a while. I think I was there for a year and a half or something like that. Black Friday right into Christmas. Good Lord. Affluent area. Just South Hills rich people buying stuff with their accents alone. Good Lord.
In addition to working at Toys R Us, I spent a summer working at Giant Eagle, a local grocery store chain, around the 4th of July. And you're just seeing like you could not reload the corn on the cob. Fast enough. The gray hairs are just waiting for you, telling you that the corn wasn't good enough. It's not good enough. You must have more in the back.
All right.
Yeah, of course we do.
Buzz
all
Black
right, you
Friday.
Must, okay. You must have more in the back is a phrase that needs to be retired from all shopping excursions. No.
You're gonna be like, there's no back. There's no back. It's just me and you and all of this shit up here.
That's all we got.
I'm stealing that.
All right. But hey, we haven't done this before where we really got like deep into the like wrestling merchandise side of things that I recall on this show in the 497 episodes. But we want to talk Black Friday. And I think we have some experts between the guy that works at Toys R Us currently and formerly for
WWE
Corporate.
My shirt.
There you go. There it is in the background. It's just festive. And also somebody who has school-aged children who love wrestling toys. I figure you guys are sending me pictures all the time of the crazy stuff you find. And
Sorg, I appreciate you pointing that out. I mean, I do have those kids, but I don't acknowledge them. I'm probably not the best person for this. Thing. You should ask Matt Carlin's for.
Oh, right. Of course.
What you need to do is if anything makes LB's face light up with childlike wonder, then you know this is a quality gift idea for the wrestling fan on your shopping list.
John Cena footy pajamas.
John Cena 31 inch doll.
Can I interest you in a John Cena 31 inch action figure, LB?
Can you? Oh, man.
I'm going to tell you, there ain't a store on the face of the earth that isn't trying to unload these this Black Friday.
Let me give
two items to give
some Matt Carlin's background. First of all, he sends a picture. I forget if it was Facebook, Slack, or text message of the 27-man Royal Rumble playset and how it's the most effective toy.
Oh, look, don't even get me started, Sorg.
All right. Now, hold on. This was on Slack because I remember this specifically. I had to go into work the next day, and I'm like, we have that at the store. Sorg, would you like to know some of the people in that 27?
They're from like 3 years ago, aren't they? Is Great Khali in it?
Oh no, Sorg. Sorg, it's even better. Okay, this is just off of memory. This is some of the names I remember. The Mouth of the South, Jimmy Hart.
What?
Yokozuna. I believe Daniel Bryan was still in there. Chris Jericho, I believe, is in there. Sergeant Slaughter.
Okay.
And the most interesting one that just – and Randy Orton's in there, but it's Randy Orton like when he's punched his Viper pose. So you can't even treat it like it's a real action figure, even though it's like the plastic army.
It's a $12 set with like a bunch of minifigures. So, it is what it is.
And you know that the Royal Rumble is known for its 27-man over-the-top rope battle royal.
It's a damn disaster, Sorg. It's possibly the worst toy fail I've ever seen in my life. How hard is it to put three more damn action figures in there? I misspoke. They are not action figures. These are inaction figures. These are tiny army men.
It hit the limit.
Three more in there and jack the price up a buck and be on your way. Come on.
You know what? If we just like record you guys complaining about wrestling toys for the next 15 minutes, I think we have our segment.
We're just getting started. Sorry.
All right. Let's go down a little bit. I'm just going to go down what you guys put in the Slack here. First of all, I want to point out this kid just looking longingly up at this John Cena that is taller than him sitting down action figure here.
This is Childlike Wonder.
This is Childlike Wonder at its finest. These were very popular as stuff a bus last week. Like, I walked in with my couple of action figures, like regular size action figures, and Big Bob's like, yeah, we got like a bunch of 3 foot tall John Cena's and Rock's in there. And I'm like, I just got regular size figures, sir. But they're on sale. Tell me about these, Matt.
Well, I mean, first of all, nobody wants these.
Nope.
Which is why they're all being given away to little kids at Stuff a Bus. No offense to the Stuff a Bus. But yeah, I think this ad with the Childlike Wonder, this is the Toys R Us ad, which is $24.99 on Black Friday, 31-inch John Cena. And yes, The Rock is out there. And there's also a Daniel Bryan variety floating around out there. He may not be at Toys R Us. He may only be at Kmart. And does anyone want to make a joke about the 31-inch Daniel Bryan action figure while we're on the topic?
The Daniel Bryan 31-inch action figure is actual size.
Yes, exactly. I hope Daniel Bryan thinks that's funny.
He will.
I should also point out, looks like Kmart is doing that same deal. $24.99, Sorg, for 31 inches. That's a deal.
There are many places where you can go 24.
There are many places you can get 31 inches for $24.99, Sorgatron. Let's move on, Sorg. This next one's really interesting. I like this one from the Target ad here. Have you seen this one?
It's pulling up the entire flyer. I'm not sure if I'm looking at the right thing here. Tell me what I'm looking for, sir.
I'm rolling shotgun with you, so I'm going to try to help you out on this one. This is a pretty it's a pretty nice set here. Waiting for my internet to load up, but yeah.
Oh, the Four Horsemen.
Is that the Four Horsemen set?
This is the Four Horsemen set. And Sorg, I will help you get. We're looking for. Just take one click to the right, and you should be able to find that sexy looking piece of beefcake, Arn Anderson, over here.
It is a Target exclusive too. It's a Target exclusive.
Target exclusive Four Horsemen four action figure set. I believe this is Anderson, Flair, Wyndham, and Tully.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
$29.99. Save $20, Sorg. That's at the Target.
I've seen that on sale at Target for months now. No one buys it because they forgot who Ric Flair is and they don't know who the other three people are.
You know where it is selling? The South.
Is it?
I think so. Like in Charlotte, you know what I mean? Like, I bet they can't keep them on the shelves down there.
If anyone could go down to a Toys R Us, or I'm sorry, a Target in Greenville, South Carolina, and see if they have these in stock, by God, the Greenville Target's going to be on fire. All right, let's just go down the line here, Sorg. This is a quick one for the video game folks and for Bobby. Bobby FJ Town, I should say. Are we doing this here, Sorg?
Yeah, I got it right here.
Okay, great. Okay, yeah. This is the GameStop is doing WWE 2K16, I believe, for the Xbox One here for $49.99, which may not sound okay. That sounds okay.
No, that is not a good deal. That is only $10 off.
Listen to me, Mad Mike. Listen, you're not just getting the video game. They're throwing in one of those Funko, right? Stone Cold Steve Austin. Pop vinyl figures along with it.
That's okay, guess how much that Stone Cold Steve Austin pop vinyl is, Macaron?
I don't know, it's like $7 or something 10, 15 like that.
Bucks? Yeah, roughly. It's a shit deal.
Okay, so it's like $17.99 off, $18 off. That's
not bad.
Yeah, it's something. It's something. Oh man, crapping all over my deals, yo.
Well, Toys R Us has a buy one get one 40% off deal for video games.
Damn it, man, Mike. Do you work on commission over there?
I wish, Sorg, I would be rich.
Does this everything, every video game in the store there, Mike?
Yes, every video.
Well, hot diggity. And that's only on Black Friday? Is that when that's going down?
I believe it's from Thanksgiving when we open to close Saturday, because we stay open the whole time.
Very nice. What do we got here? We got this Big Lots ad up here, Sorg.
Big Lots? I missed the Big Lots. Hold on a second.
I think we just threw the Big Lots ad in here today.
Oh, okay. Okay. It's towards the bottom here. Okay. I'm on my way. Yeah, I see this. I think
Big Lots is opening at like 7 a.m. on Thanksgiving.
Oh, jeez. You're
exactly right, Mike. It is opening. This is buy one, get one 50% off WWE action figures. And they're mixing and matching with other assorted loot. So you can, get your Captain America, get your Chris Jericho, and then you're all good to go on that one.
Okay. Okay. And I see empty WWE figures are saying the $250 to $20 ones too. So
yeah, I've never seen the $250 action figures, but I don't know. Maybe they still have the. I can't even imagine. Who knows?
They probably have
the Rumblers still in stock or something like that. What else have we not gotten to here?
The ugly sweaters, which I know Kevin Owens was wearing on his interview with Michael Cole this week.
Oh my God! Yeah. Well, yeah. I mean, obviously. The WWE shop online is doing all sorts of stuff. They've got ugly sweaters, some of which are actually, kind of nice. You can kind of get away with wearing them, and kind of one of those perfect wrestling shirts that only wrestling fans will recognize.
Oh yeah,
no one else will think much of.
Grandma's not going to get this
sweet spot. And they got some scarves going too, which are pretty nice. I always appreciate a nice scarf. Like some of the other stuff, it's real kitsch. There's like ornaments and Santa hats. There is a Sting Nutcracker, Sorg. If you can find the Sting Nutcracker, it's terrifying.
Hold on. I'm on the Finn Balor ugly sweater with the teeth and everything, and the Fight Owens Fight KO one with little Christmas trees in between. I want to point out there. That's pretty nice. Yeah.
So you
say, because I mean, I remember when they did like the zombies, right? The zombie version.
Oh, they did, didn't they? Yeah,
for Halloween.
So we got winter wear. Oh, there's the scarves. Those are nice.
They are pretty nice. They're kind of tasteful.
Yeah, one says hit hard. There you go. and hats and such.
can you do a search for the Sting Nutcracker? See if you can find the Sting Nutcracker.
Why we haven't had a Gable, Ready William and Gable towel, though, is beyond me.
Well, I don't think the world is ready yet. I mean,
I think it takes a while for those things to kind of filter up through. Sting Nutcracker does not turn any results in.
Are you kidding me? Hang on. I'll try to drop it into the chat here.
Their search is not great on here. If you can slack it to
me.
Can
appreciate what's going on here.
Let's see. Winter. Oh, wait. I saw it pop up on some Nutcrackers pop up. Oh, jeez. That is frightening. What the hell is this?
Did you get that?
Hold on. It's loading up.
Let me see.
Hold on. We're loading that up. And the nightmares are made.
There you go. Right there.
Look at that guy.
Sting Nutcracker. Look at that. Sting!
That is frightening. That is absolutely frightening. That's like, if you want to scare your kids into bed on Christmas Eve, that's the way to do it. It's like, hover this above their bed. All freaking nightmares.
I like that we brought
throws
too for...
What's that, Mike?
I said I like that we brought back the tapestry throws too.
That's good.
Everyone, I actually have... on my bed, a Stone Cold Steve Austin tapestry throw from 1998.
Oh, jeez. Oh, nice. While we're on the WWE shop thing, I kind of stumbled upon this, but if you go, a lot of people go to coupons.com, and there's a ton of WWE shop coupons on coupons.com. Just go there and search for WWE, and you will find a deal, and they'll give you a coupon code, and you can save like 20% or something like that off of whatever you're into doing. Sorg, let's take a look at Shop TNA. I really want to look at Shop TNA before we go home here, because they have got an item, and this is marked down so drastically, I think I might be ready to get one for one of you guys.
Wait, hold on.
This year,
is it the Aces and Eights Fest?
No. I wanted to let you.
Damn
well,
it.
Actually, I think I'm going to get this for you this year, Mike, because I know what a huge Sorg, did you find this site yet? I know that I put this in the Slack.
I'm on the site, but I just have like a Christmas commercial of sorts going on.
Yeah, you just
here.
Need to scroll down just a skosh. Okay. Just scroll down a skosh there, and you'll find a link. Actually, just go up a little bit, and you'll find a little link. It says guitars 80% off.
What?
Guitars 80% off.
What the hell?
I'm gonna click on that.
Jeff Jarrett laser engraved guitar.
Oh yeah.
Manufacturer
suggested retail price $299. You can have it right now for the cool low price of 60%. Or I'm sorry, $60.
I wonder if it's like actually even a decent guitar at that point.
Nope.
I can't say. I mean,
I've seen them in person, Sorg.
Yeah.
Someone has purchased this for you to witness in person?
Uh-huh. The last time TNA was in Poughkeepsie. Oh man, the kid two rows down from me, I don't know why, he bought a Jeff Jarrett guitar. At that point I questioned not only his choice of purchase, but every single one of his life choices. Every single one of them.
Antonio Garza really wants to direct everybody's attention to the Earl Hebner Hall of Fame T-shirt.
I was just about to say it.
I wanted to also let everybody know that they are selling $5 T-shirts on TNA and on the TNA shop. And frankly, most of them you'll never see on TV again. But there is a DJZ T-shirt for $5.
Wait.
So go buy a DJZ T-shirt.
There it is.
Yeah.
Actually, I think this might be a good point. You could buy the one from there, but I recommend going to his Pro Wrestling Tees if you really want to support him, because he probably gets a little bit bigger chunk than he's going to get off of that $5 T-shirt. So
I just want to see if it was actually a decent shirt, and it's not bad.
It does. It actually is a decent shirt. They got something good with that. But speaking of Pro Wrestling Tees,
right on.
Oh, you want this one?
Yeah, tell them. I thought you were going to catch this one. Sorry,
big
sorry.
Sale,
you kind of caught me off guard.
Big sale
I thought
starting.
You were going to do the hard sell then.
Big sale starting Wednesday. They're going to save 20% off of everything on the store, including DJZ, friends of the show like that. Or if you've been waiting to pick up your Wrestling Mayhem Show shirt at prowrestlingtees.com/WMS to start with. 20% off everything for that. Promo code Black Friday to do that. Partially related and sort of an ad, indiewrestling.us is going to have a Black Friday sale as well. I think we're going to do both DVD and digital download sales, so if you've been waiting to pick up any of those, this would be the weekend to do it. And that's your supporting indies and more directly.
Hypothetical situation, Sorg, if you perhaps know like a hardcore Dalton Castle fan in your life, you go to Pro Wrestling Tees, you get him a T-shirt, you go to indiewrestling.us, you get him that fresh new Dalton Castle DVD that's out there, mm-hmm. throw those together in a box, happy days.
You know, there are, at the RWA shows, the Renegade Wrestling Alliance, there are people that come to our DVD table, and they explicitly are buying Christmas gifts from our DVD table of RWA.
Makes a great Christmas gift.
Yes,
man.
It does.
The gift of wrestling.
It does. It does. Is that everything worth getting into? I saw a Kmart ad in here.
I think we covered that. That's I think 20, that was more of just the 31-inch figures. Let's put it this way. They can't get rid of these. They're giving them away. I say wait a year. They should be $5 by next Black Friday in 2016.
And then we can just buy all of them, and then when somebody's not looking, like I would love just to, like when somebody leaves a room in an office and they come back and they're just the boardroom filled with the 30-inch figures just looking at them, you know, just Daniel Bryan's and Rock's and John Cena's looking at them. So there you go. Black Friday!
LB, did you see anything you like?
I'm experiencing a little bit of what is the German word, Schadenfreude, about the TNA stuff. that's just kind of hilarious to me.
LB, have you ever seen the Aces and Eights vest?
Oh no. I have not.
Yeah, when we used to do the wrestling game show, sometimes when we were waiting to start, we would play the "How much is TNA selling this shit for" game. And oh man, that's a fun game. I kind of want to do a special version for Black Friday.
Oh, you know what, Sorg? You're right. I did forget to mention one thing at Kmart. It's the this is pretty fun. It's also make you kind of sad too.
Yeah.
It is the 5-pack fan favorite figures. It's Ambrose, Rollins, Reigns, Rusev, and WWE.com number one vote getter Cesaro. Pour one out
for $40.
Get some Cesaro for the one in your life.
Go check it out. All right. And like I said, check out indiewrestling.us this week. And if you haven't yet signed up for the newsletter, we'll be sending emails out reminding you of the sales all weekend long. You can pick up stuff, including, like I said, Renegade Wrestling Alliance, the open season. Just sent out the DVDs today for open season 2015, including Amazing Red taking on Flip Kendrick, amongst other great, great matches over there. Some women's wrestling and so much more. IWC Unbreakable with Rhino taking on John McChesney and Jimmy Nuts. Some other great guys like Dylan Bosick, who I think just popped up in Ring of Honor, actually, over the weekend. And friends of the show like Andrew Palace. And Border City Wrestling, like we talked about with Joe Dombrowski last week. A lot of those titles and documentaries. Finding Zach Gowen, the documentary on there. Legend of Virgil and his traveling merchandise table, and so much more. Check it out, indiewrestling.us, including the column Around the Indies by Matt Carlins.
It's fun. You'll enjoy it.
There you go. Check out what happened last week in Sorgatron Media, and we'll be right back.
Sawtooth got business to attend to.
Welcome to the future and skipping about 10 years of technology.
You didn't even have to go through the Palm Trio days or the BlackBerry days.
You didn't even have to go through the days where we didn't have cut and paste on iOS.
You're playing a professional, right? Who's playing the wrestling character. So those two layers exist in the game. The reward systems in the game are all about, like, you can get more cool stuff for your character. You can raise your stats. You can get new moves. You can get a valet. You can maybe gain more booking authority, change your gimmick, all that kind of stuff.
Going on ads in wrestling, I think the greatest one I've ever seen is the King of the Ring 1998 promo package where it's like Hell in the Cell with Taker and Mankind. And it was like First Blood with Austin and Kane, and then it just goes into Super Soaker. It brings you
Super Soaker of Blood.
Get it belong to me now. Ha! Turn the camera off!
We are back. Check out that in a very awkwardly sexy Sawtooth Willie last week, I guess. Let's get into our big question of the week with Papa Lunchbox. Hi.
Hi, Sork.
Hi.
It's so cold in my house.
It's so cold. It is here, too. This is the year where we freeze our podcasts off.
That's correct. That is correct. But that is not going to stop us from podcasting our brains out. It's going to be amazing. So this question, no-brainer. This question is a no-brainer. It's super easy, and it is a question that we ask every year. Sorg, tell me, and everyone tell me, what are you thankful for in professional wrestling? I'm thankful for NXT.
Yes.
I'll go first. It's obvious. I'm thankful for NXT. Not only because it's good and entertaining wrestling under the WWE banner, because it is forcing so many other organizations and so many other wrestlers to up their game. It's great. I love seeing it. Thank you, Pilgrim Jesus, for NXT.
I will extend that one partially because, well, NXT is there, of course, but the WWE network in general, in a world where I've cut the cord.
You're welcome, Sorg. God, I can't take all the credit, but I will.
In a world where I've cut the cord so many times that, you know, I don't even see commercials, but yet I can just turn on something when I just want something on and don't want to think about it. And that thing is something about professional wrestling. As was the case today, because, you know, I have a weird schedule because of podcast day and everything. So I was taking kind of a downtime around 4:30 here, and I could just put on the TV, fire up that Fire TV stick, and watch WWE Network, and the W List was on, and followed by Rivalries, and I can just go, as long as it's not Total Divas, because Total Divas is the cops of WWE Network.
Oh my god, that's so accurate.
That's true.
If you watch the stream and turn it on, be like, I'd love to watch some wrestling kind of thing right now. Oh crap, Total Divas is on. Moving on. I'm going to go watch Fall Brawl 98 or something. But you can do that, and that's an amazing thing. Like, I was just kind of pondering on that today of how at our fingertips this is in the day and age that we are paying $10 a month, most of us. WWE pay-per-view piracy should be all but dead at this point. We're talking about how many more people watch WrestleMania than ever before because of this, and WWE is profiting off of this thing. And it's such a great service to the fans of it, whether you do or don't like what's going on today. And then there's different programming, and I think it's really cool. I mean, we're all loving the Breaking Ground series and other things that are popping up there. Maybe not Swerved as much, but hey, there's going to be some misses, Table 3, you know, stuff like that. It's just so awesome to see this kind of thing and let it permeate your life. And something like that. And thankfully, so can I, as a secondarily thankfully thing, so thankful that I have a wife that tolerates my obsession with professional wrestling.
Yes, an underrated commodity for sure. So
there's people out there. You may have know these people that are pro wrestling fans, but have to live this existence where they have to sidestep their fandom around their significant other because they absolutely abhor professional wrestling. And I just can't imagine living like that. I don't know. It's crazy. But That's mine. Carlins?
Well, all right. I guess I'll steal what Mad Mike is probably thinking. I'm thankful for Lucha Underground, my freaking jam, and Mad Mike's too. So I'm not going to say too much more about Lucha Underground other than I'm very thankful for it. I will do an extra aside, completely out of left field, only because it recently came to mind. I'm thankful for Dean Malenko, and I'm thankful for all the great memories the wrestling dad has given me over the years. You know, recently they did a Talk Is Jericho podcast, and he had Dean Malenko on his podcast. And I never really like heard Dean Malenko in that setting before. He's like this. He's like hidden away from us now that he's retired. I never even hear from him. Hell, I rarely heard from him when he was wrestling. Anyway, Dean Malenko, you were a great wrestler. You were one of the primary reasons that I got fully stoked and into professional wrestling in the late 90s. Watching you in the ring made me crazy. Just watching the precision in the moves made me appreciate professional wrestling on a whole new level. And Dean, I know you're watching. I just want to say you are appreciated. Just like Tupac appreciates his mama, I appreciate Dean Malenko. Now, Mike, say something nice about Lucha Underground.
Well, I was going to say I'm very thankful for Lucha Underground and for friend of the show, Chris DeJoseph, who is a fan of us. But you know what? I'm going to shock the podcast world. I'm thankful for TNA Impact.
Shut your mouth.
No.
Now, hold on. I am thankful because watching TNA for 8 weeks a month and podcasting about it for roughly 2 hours a month.
Wait. Did you just say 8 weeks a month?
That's what it feels like. I meant to say 8 hours.
Okay. I just wanted to
8 hours. Yes, sure, cool. 8 hours. I meant to say 8 hours. It feels like 8 weeks. But watching TNA for 8 hours a month and podcasting about it for roughly 2 hours a month is cheaper than therapy. Because I get to be angry and just yell at my TV for all the stupid things we do. And also, I am legitimately thankful because without TNA, we would not have Ethan Carter.
I'd like to piggyback on that too and also say why I'm thankful for TNA Wrestling. I'm thankful that there is a giant, insane money panda willing to spend all this money and give professional wrestlers a place to work and ply their trade and lose unknown amounts of money just so that these professional wrestlers can live their lives.
Praise
and that's why
be.
I'm thankful for TNA.
Praise be to the money panda. Okay, we had some other comments to this question throughout the day. Alex Carr says he's thankful for the opportunity to be writing about SmackDown every week because more often than not, I enjoy a lot of what I watch from that show. I'm with him on that. SmackDown is completely underrated and overlooked as far as I'm concerned. If we can just switch that with Raw, we'd be okay. That's complete honesty.
I think as we mentioned on this show from time to time, Sorg, SmackDown is perfect. It's only 2 hours, and John Cena's never on it. So it is the perfect wrestling show.
You are 50% correct.
I'm thankful for my local indie wrestling promotions, especially now that I've started doing projects with one in particular. And I'm thankful for podcasts like WMS covering the best and not so best of pro wrestling. You know, we should just do a side podcast that's just like everything that sucks in wrestling. Like, just like, let's just pour all the negativity into one place.
I direct you to the Impact Wrestling Midweek War podcast.
That's true. Okay.
Say, isn't that what this is for? I thought that's what we were doing here.
Okay, all right. And also our buddy Ed Burke, Magma Priest, Ed Burke 37 on the Twitters. He says, Lucha Underground, always thankful for Lucha Underground. And also Yin's guys for helping me reconnect with something I enjoyed for Mayhem's Giving. So thank you so much for that. Also from the chat room, Bobby FJ Town is thankful for the new day. Kevin Owens' Twitter account, Squisher, Snake Eyes, and Hair Flip. Cesaro and the fact that Chris Jericho invented Thanksgiving and thankfulness. show title recommendation, thankful for the Money Panda from Mike. Garza is thankful for indie and international promotions because they keep me a fan of professional wrestling. I'm thankful for Garza for translating Mexican wrestling for us in the Facebook group. Thank you for that. Wheels is thankful for working with so many great wrestling promotions in PA and West Virginia. And I ruined the jamboree. What?
I just wanted to scream, you ruined our jamboree.
Oh yeah.
Going off of that, I'm thankful for Kofi Kingston's hair.
Or you mean Xavier?
And Xavier Woods' hair.
Oh yeah, yeah, yeah.
I'm thankful for Garza for translating Matanza for us the moment Lucha Underground mentioned Matanza for the first time.
It's good stuff. It's good stuff. All right, let us know what you're thankful for. Hashtag Mayhem's Giving on the Twitter. Let's go with it. Why not? Let us know what you're thankful for in wrestling and beyond. Okay, guys, would you like to play a game? Speaking of Garza.
You want to play a game? Is it a sexy game?
Yeah.
It is a family holiday, Sorg, so there must be a game.
It can be, if you hear these rules. This is actually, he emailed us back on November 10th, this, and we've just had loaded shows the last couple of weeks. But I keep putting it in the queue, and then something comes up, and we finally are getting to it. So Antonio Garza, thewrestlingrevolution.com, emails. Hey, Wrestling Mayhem Show boys. Is that Dalton Castle reference? I don't know. I haven't emailed in ages, so I figured why not. I want to play a quick game, the Mary Fuck Kill version of wrestling. In this case, it's Push, NXT, and Fire. So from WWE main roster and the main roster only, who would you push, send to developmental, and fire? Go. Happy podcasting day, Ciro out. P.S. Fuck Bailey. Long live the Queen Dana.
Well, to be fair, this game, if we're doing strict fuck, marry, kill rules, you have to name three people and then we each say what we would do. So I'm going to throw a suggestion.
Okay. Hold on. Before you do that, I just want to say for the record, I would marry, fuck, and then kill Dolph Ziggler. He seems like he'd be fun for all three.
You wouldn't fuck him before you marry him? I feel like that is something you have to know before you marry someone.
No, I don't know. You know, you got to get that those sweet golden curls on lock, or you enter him and then murder him.
Fair enough. All right. So I'll present the first one. All right. Push NXT or fire 3 members of the Shield.
Oh, push NXT.
Yeah. Bam. Open up strong.
Push Ambrose, NXT Seth, and fire Roman. If I had to have a choice, I mean, any different?
Yeah. Mine would be different.
Yeah.
I would push Seth because he's so very good and reminds me of Edge. And I would NXT Roman because he needs the work. Mm-hmm. And I would fire Ambrose.
Why?
Because he's leftover. Because he's leftover.
LB and I are in line. I think Ambrose could do better in a different Fed.
You imagine him in Lucha Underground?
Yep. That's exactly what I was thinking.
There you go. Carlins?
I would fire Seth Rollins because he's hurt and he'll never be the same again. I would NXT Roman Reigns. Hey, I'm just saying what's going to happen.
He's young. He's still so young. Oh.
You keep telling yourself these
things. And Bureau judging from the pictures.
He only tore 5 ligaments and whatnot.
Can we do a reality? Hold on. Can we do a reality show on network where it's Brian and Rollins figuring out what to do in their post wrestling careers, and it's just
they announced the thing that we talked about.
Which thing?
The wrestling road trips.
Yeah, I know. I feel like that episode.
We had this conversation.
Well, you realize they've been pretty much testing this. Like an entire episode of Total Divas was the road trip videos. Like that was the soft pilot for this thing.
I know. Jen Carlins and I said it should be a show.
Yeah,
that was one of the best Total Divas episodes.
Thank you for listening, Vince. Thank you. Now please. Go away so we can have real people run the show.
Please send the commission check to what's the address, Sorgatron? Something.
1234 Mary Fake Street. Street.
Podcast Lane.
Podcast Lane.
Avenue. Anyway.
Parts unknown.
Scary part is my address is on the website.
PO Box 316, care of parts unknown.
I'm shocked I haven't had weird mail yet. So actually, I did get weird mail, and that was scary. And it was just confetti.
Someone sent you confetti.
Someone glitter bombed you.
Yeah, no. Somebody was sending me holiday cards with just like glitter in it, and did this for like 3 holidays in a row, and it was freaking me out. And they confessed that
was it Jimmy DeMarco?
No. It was an exterior family member, I guess we could say. And I was like, you don't realize how scared I was. And they're like, I guess they were checking Facebook and Twitter to see if I was reacting to it. And I did the first time. But then when it happened the second time, I'm like, we're not saying anything about this.
I know what you're getting for Christmas, Sorg.
Okay, so someone else has to name 3.
Okay, all right. Matt, go ahead.
The 3 members of the New Day. Go.
Damn it!
Oh,
that's good.
Oh, damn it.
All right. I'm into it. Push, Big E. Mm-hmm. Man, so good. NXT. Kofi, because I would like to see what he would do with some of the guys in NXT, and not for malicious reasons, but just because he's left. You got fire the unicorn.
You know, I'm with you on that, but fire Xavier because he's got a degree. He can always just get a better job the day he doesn't get hurt. he's gonna be fine.
My answer: fire Xavier. Because he'll be all right. He's got a PhD.
Yeah.
He'll figure out. He's a smart guy.
He's going to get a job reviewing for Kotaku. He's going to be fun.
He's going to be the next PewDiePie.
Push Kofi before it's too late and NXT Big E. Don't worry, we'll be back.
Okay. I'm going to shock you guys. Push Xavier. NXT Big E and fire Kofi. He's had his shot, and I think he would do better somewhere else.
From the chat, Eamon is saying, push Big E, NXT, Kofi, fire Xavier, he will have a home at Inspire Wrestling. That's the thing too, you know?
I hope he would put together a stable called the Tromboners.
I mean, because anytime I see anybody, this is legit, anybody that I see gets let go from WWE, I go to certain people and say, so when are we seeing so-and-so here, you know? And that's Inspire too, you know, to be honest. So it's like, all right.
Sammy Callahan. Excuse me.
I can't wait for Sammy Callahan, Ray Rowe at Inspire Pro Wrestling in a couple months. I mean, I hope I didn't unknowingly spoil something. But something like that. But okay. This. and I have not talked to Eamon for like a week, so I have no idea. And that just dropped today that I'm aware of that Crow / Sammy Callahan left. So, anyways, watch out for Billy Gunn coming up. I'll just say that, somewhere.
All right, so Sorg, now you give a list of three wrestlers.
All right, this one I wanted to give for Carlin's. Let's go Sheamus, Rusev, Barrett, and Carlin's. You have to go first.
Push Wade Barrett, baby. No doubt. All day. Damn it. What to do with these other two stiffs? I'm between a rock and a hard place because I've said so many nice things about Sheamus. Now I have to throw him under the bus. It's just how far under. all right, we'll go all the way. We'll fire Sheamus. We'll NXT Rusev. He'll be fine.
Sheamus will have a home with Impact Wrestling, I'm sure.
All right.
Can't wait to see Sheamus in Inspire Pro.
I'll say push Rusev, NXT Barrett, and fire Sheamus.
You know, couldn't Sheamus have an interesting threesome tag team with the Warbeards or War Machine with Ray
War Machine?
Rowe?
Yeah, Hansel. Sure. Sheamus and the War Machine? I like it. It sounds like a bad Nickelodeon show.
Well, you'll be.
There's so many things. Sheamus versus Nakamura. I mean, who knows? The evidence is wide open now.
this one's pretty easy. You can push Wade Barrett because I dearly love Wade Barrett. Mm-hmm. And I don't frankly give a shit what happens to the other two. I don't want to say something that terrible. They're nice guys. they can both be released. Who gives a shit? I'll tell you what. We'll release Rusev and we'll send Sheamus down to NXT where they can teach him how to wrestle.
Okay.
Rusev and Lucha Underground will be pretty amazing. Rusev versus the Mac.
You know, I think any of those three guys could have a pretty good life at Lucha Underground. I think anybody can be made cold at Lucha Underground almost.
That's true.
So, I mean,
oh, all right. Guys, I have a really tough one. Or LB, do you have one?
I was working one out. Who is it going to be? Actually, I did have one that involved Wade Barrett at one point. But we're gonna go in a different direction. Okay, so we've got John Cena, Roman Reigns, and Big Show.
Oh,
sorry, you made this too easy.
Okay, all right.
Which one are
you made
push?
That too easy. That's way too easy.
Wait, which one were you going to push? Which one would you push?
No, because now I'm kind of curious which Roman one you Reigns. Guys are going to fire. So push Roman, okay.
Mm-hmm. Put John Cena in NXT so he could have 5-star matches at every takeover.
Mm-hmm.
And fire Big Show just for a mercy.
Okay, okay. I was going to say, yeah, Big Show needs to go. All respect to Big Show. He's had an awesome career, but he needs to do other things. He can go do acting, be the big guy, you know, do something else. He just awesome that he's in as good a health for his size. Don't push it. You know what I mean?
So, don't push it.
Push?
Yeah. I don't know. What do you guys got? I guess I didn't say anything else, did I? No, yeah, push Roman to do something new. John Cena, NXT, make some new stars out of that.
Mm-hmm.
So, LB, Matt? LB, Matt?
Oh, I thought I said. No, I agree. I agree. Okay. Yeah, John Cena and NXT to have amazing matches, fire Big Show, and move right. Roman Reigns up the line.
Like, they could actually do that, send John Cena into NXT as, like, Kang the Conqueror, and he wants to destroy the future before it can even happen.
Oh, God.
Except he realizes that everyone in NXT can kick out of the AA.
Yeah.
He's trying his power.
Like, he's like, okay, hold on. Sammy did it. Owens did it. Neville did it. There's a fucking pattern here. Mm-hmm. I need to go to the source.
I'm waiting for Breeze to do it just so I could finally be like, that's it.
I couldn't handle John Cena actually going to NXT. Because the volume of just the internet wanting to piss blood because John Cena's encroaching on their holy ground, it would make me want to end my life. I wouldn't be able to escape it.
Oh, God.
All right. On that note, we got to move on. Let me know, what did you learn from wrestling this week?
Oh, we got one here. So, Sorg, can we do one more?
Oh, if you want. If you want.
The wheels just threw one into the chat room, so I'm going to let you guys have this one.
Oh, no.
Here we go. I'm assuming you mean Sami Zayn.
Yeah.
He's the only Sami employed.
Sami Zayn, Neville, and Finn Balor.
Now, not all on the main roster, so, but still, outside the box to those roles. I guess I'll go. Push Baylor. Man, I'm sorry, Neville. You're kind of losing out here. I'm sorry, Neville. But between all these guys, I want to see Sammy NXT being awesome. Jeez, I hate to, but sorry, Neville, you're gone.
I would say push Sammy. Finn can stay in NXT, and I'm sorry, Neville. I'll see you in Spire Pro.
See you in Spire Pro.
I actually completely agree with Matt. All the way down the line. That's spot on.
All right. I'm going to push Balor, send Neville back to NXT, and maybe we'll eventually see El Generico in Lucha Underground when I get rid of Sami Zayn. they're just strikingly similar, but I think they like represent each other or something.
Yeah, something like that. They're just good buddies. Heyman says, push Baylor, NXT Neville, and fire Sammy again for the Inspire thing. And the fire just means...
In other words, Heyman's just basing firing based on who he wants to work with.
Push, fire, Inspire Pro Wrestling is kind of the game now. I see how it works. Okay, now, what did you learn from wrestling this week? I learned about ugly sweaters, and I learned about laser-engraved guitars that nobody should buy, for instance. Mm-hmm. But other than that... jeez. I learned that if there was a performance center in every city, you would see more incidents like the guy that got shot in Florida. Because I watched that video that was posted on the Facebook. I felt bad because I thought it was gruesome because I thought the guy died. I'm glad to see that the guy didn't die. So now we can just laugh at him. But he did get shot. But he was charging at an officer. I can't believe they released the entire video, to be honest. But yeah, the guy, if you haven't seen it yet, so this is a guy that was like basically, it was like the third or fourth time he had been there. He's basically stalking the performance center. He has these videos on YouTube where it's like, I want to be the biggest NXT star. And he's doing Shawn Michaels poses outside the front door and like laying on the ground and yelling at people. And even you hear somebody inside the venue saying, oh, I always miss when this guy's here. I finally get to see him, like in the part of the video they showed. And then I keep thinking, I was like, no, really, if there was more access, if there was like a WWE home office in major cities across the country, you would see more of this. At least people being insane like this, you know, or like the guy running in, you know, there's just crazy fans, right? And you gave somebody in Orlando accessibility to WWE satellite office, basically, with the performance center. But that's what I learned. Who else got one?
I learned that ZC's finally figuring out how hard this whole wrestling thing is. Mm-hmm. I can't wait to see, like, we may literally see him quit on this show. Mm-hmm. Like on Breaking Ground, he may actually just walk up and quit.
But so many people are following his story. I can't believe he bought an RV to live in.
And all right, and you know, I can believe that. It's the fact that he called it the groupie bus. I don't think he knows what that implies.
He's not touring anywhere.
He also, I'm assuming, is not just fucking randos in Orlando. I'm guessing.
Okay.
Based on his limited social skills that we saw on Tough Enough, I'm assuming.
He's very charismatic, Mike.
Mm-hmm. Sure he was for the first episode.
Anyways, LB, yes. LB, Matt?
Yeah, I got one.
Okay.
For reasons that are completely baffling to me, I don't understand them at all. Shit, I already forgot his name. Shit. That fucking guy who ruined everything.
Sheamus?
Vince Russo.
Oh.
Vince Russo.
Vince Russo continues to put out statements and talk as if he is still in any way relevant to professional wrestling, as if there is anyone left on the planet who gives even the tiniest fuck about what he says. But he puts out these blog posts and as if they're words of wisdom coming from a trusted and reliable source when it comes to professional wrestling, when nobody fucking cares what Vince Russo thinks about Vince McMahon's job and what the WWE is doing. 0% of the population gives even the tiniest shit pebble about Vince Russo's opinion on who should get pushed and who should get fired. Vince Russo can fuck himself as long as he does it quietly and away from the internet where no one has to see it.
So are you saying Vince Russo has been playing push NXT fire? Okay.
Nope.
Okay. All right.
Well, we'll join you next week on Wrestling Mayhem Show, where our guest is Vince Russo.
Great. I'm coming in the studio and I'm going to fuck him in the mouth.
To that one, actually. This is weird, Sork. I was kind of thinking about Russo, too, for what I learned from wrestling this week. I learned that the four episodes of Raw between the 1998 Survivor Series and the Rock Bottom pay-per-view might be the best stretch of WWF television you've ever seen in your life. And even people who lived through it and watched it like me had forgotten how awesome this was. This is like the birth of the corporation. This is China going on a date with Mark Henry. This is Hawk getting pushed off the top of the Titantron by Draws. This is this is the Undertaker trying to embalm Stone Cold. This is Stone Cold and Kane stuffing Paul Bearer down a manhole. This is basically the highlight reel of the Attitude Era is crammed into these 4 weeks. Go watch these four episodes of Raw between the 98 Survivor Series and the Rock Bottom pay-per-view. They are just majestic, magical, fantastic, took me back. Nostalgia everywhere. I can't handle it. I can't even, Sorg.
Matt, why do I have a feeling you'll be saying the same thing after you watch the four Raws from Rock Bottom to the Royal Rumble?
No, I don't think so.
Mm.
I don't think so, because I kind of slipped. I'm just starting on those. I'm telling you right now.
Okay. From the chat, Bobby F. Daytown learned that Sheamus and Mojo Rawley won him over a bit this week. It's been a long, strange week. I'm not saying what Garza put in the chat room. Because Wheels.
Jesus Christ,
no,
Garza.
No.
Too soon, Garza.
Wheels. I don't understand this, but Wheels learned that
I get it, Sorg.
Tyler Breeze listens to Awesome Cast? Why is that?
Because Tyler Breeze used the word googs.
He did?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
The googs understands. The googs is looking out for you. And Tyler Breeze knows about the Goos. Watch Awesome Cast from a couple weeks ago for that one. All righty. And he used it in a backstage interview. Oh man.
Yeah, Sorg, we're done, you should Goog it.
I'll Goog that. I will. The Googs helps me out, man. Guys, it's been a Wrestling Mayhem Show.
Thank you so much. That in conversation so it stays cool.
Oh, you know what? If this Tyler Breeze gimmick doesn't work out for him, he can come back next Survivor Series as the Gobbly Googler.
You know how long? You know how long I've been using the term Google Juice when I talk about SEO?
That sounds dirty.
You do the things, you have interaction and good content on your site, and it gives you good Google Juice and helps your search rankings. Guys, it's been a Wrestling Mayhem Show. Thank you so much for joining us. WrestlingMayhemShow.com. Subscribe to us. To connect with us on Twitter and Facebook and the Facebook group especially. Check out the other shows. Support us on Patreon if you're digging this stuff. Or just share it with your friends. Here's a challenge. Be thankful for the Mayhem Show and share it with one friend or family member this week over that turkey leg there on Thursday night, please. And how have you been doing? How's your year been, Sonny? You know, I've listened to this great podcast called The Wrestling Mayhem Show. That's so educational. I learned about wrestling toys. I learned about, what else did we talk about? I learned about Roman Reigns and other educational things and the Googs. And the
TV ratings.
With TV ratings. Yeah, mm-hmm. It's been a weird show. It's been a weird, weird show. And also join us live.wrestlingmayhemshow.com every Tuesday around 9 p.m. Eastern time, all the way through to the Indie Mayhem Show. Next week on the Indie Mayhem Show, we have scheduled with us the Mentho Mofo. We have a lot of fun with the Renegade Wrestling Alliance. I'm not sure who we got actually tonight. I have pictures of the people, but I don't have a name. So we'll find that out in a moment here. And also, what else is there? That's it. Is that everything? Yeah. Thanks to Missy Sorg, wife of the show. We're keeping up late with our antics on Twitter and on the show notes and helping us out in the chat room as well. Unless she fell asleep in the chair, because I haven't heard from her in a while. So I'm kind of worried about her now. At DJ Lunchbox on the Twitters, Papa Lunchbox, PanelRiot.com, Sawtooth Willie on your Facebook and your YouTube.
Yep, episode 50 is on the way. Okay. It's on the way. It will be out, I promise, before the end of the week.
There you go. There you go.
But that's not Sorg. That's not all.
Oh.
Not only are we coming out with an episode 50, we are we're revamping the website. We have some new partnerships and some new things that we're excited to announce. But that'll all happen the same day that episode 50 launches. So you just have to keep an eye out for it. PanelRiot.com.
And also representing Poughkeepsie, New York, it is Mad Mike. If hopefully he doesn't come back a changed man from Black Friday at Toys R Us.
Sorg, if this is my last broadcast, I just want to say I love you all, and God bless Ethan Carter.
And also join us from the mainstream media at Mainstream Matt Carlins. Check his columns again at WrestlingMayhemShow.com. Are you doing one for the holiday this week? You don't have to.
Yeah, I got something special planned. I got something special, Matt. Something from the heart. So
Matt, are you doing the history of the TNA turkey suit?
No, I really don't want to talk about that.
Are you going to tell us the real story behind the Gobbly Gooker?
No, I don't think I'm going to do anything turkey related. I think I'm going to go towards the yams. I'm going to focus on the yams.
So you're going to talk about Taz saying yam bag?
I'm going to talk about why Taz secretly hated the colors orange and black all these years, and no, Taz, I'm not over it yet. I'm not over it at all.
All right.
Just lie to me, Taz. Lie to me and tell me you still love orange and black. Just lie to me.
And thanks to our friends in the chat room, including Bobby F. J-Town, Riz, Eamon, Heel Garza, Alex Cars from out in California, and so much more. We'll see you guys next time. Mayhem out.
If
Show is a member of the Sorgatron Media Podcast Network. Find out more at sorgatronmedia.com.